Facilities that make this program possible are provided by the City of Highland Park. Programs are produced independently by members of the community. The City of Highland Park is not affiliated with the following program or the producers of public access programming and is not responsible for the content. The following program does not reflect the opinions of the City of Highland Park.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Jennifer Dotson, and I'm your host for Poetry Today. I'm also the founder and program director for Highland Park Poetry, and I am really thrilled with my guest today. His name is William Marr. William was born in 1936 and educated in Taiwan. He came to the United States in 1961 and received his master's degree in mechanical engineering from Marquette University in 1963. And his PhD in nuclear engineering from the University of Wisconsin in 1969. After 27 years with the Argonne National Laboratory, he retired from engineering in 1996 to devote his full time and energy to his true passions, art and poetry. Dr. Marr has published more than 100 technical articles ranging from nuclear reactor safety to electric hybrid vehicle development. We can all appreciate that. He has also published in Taiwan, mainland China, and Hong Kong 21 volumes of poetry and 3 books of essays, all written in his native Chinese language under the pen name Fei Ma, and several books of translations of contemporary North American and European poetry. His first book of poems in English, this Autumn Window, published by Arbor Hill Press in 1995, was greeted with critical acclaim, and he was hailed as one of the collectible Chicago poets. I've not heard that expression. I guess that means that people want to have your books. Is that right? Okay. His second book of poetry in English, Between Heaven and Earth, was published by Publish America in 2010. And his most recent book, Chicago Serenade, is a trilingual poetry anthology, trilingual as in Chinese, English, and French poetry anthology, which was published just in 2015 in Paris. His poems appear in over 100 anthologies, including 300 Best New Poems from 1917 to 1995, published in Taiwan, and 300 Best New Chinese Poems, published in mainland China. Some of his poems are included in high school and college textbooks in Taiwan, China, England, and Germany, and have been translated into more than 10 languages, including Japanese, Korean, Malaysian, Hebrew, Indian, Spanish, German, Slavic, Romanian, and French. He has also edited and published several anthologies of Chinese and Taiwanese modern poetry. Considered one of the world's best contemporary poets writing in Chinese, Dr. Marr's poetry has enjoyed wide readership in Taiwan, Southeast Asia, mainland China, and North America. He's received numerous awards, including 3 from Taiwan for his poetry and translations. He has served in the capacity of editorial advisor and poetry contest judge to several prominent Chinese poetry journals and online poetry forums on the internet. In addition to his writing and translation, Dr. Marr also pursues other artistic interests, including painting and sculpting. He's held several solo and group art exhibitions in the Chicago area, as well as in several major cities in China over the years. During the 2008 Beijing Olympics, he was invited to participate in the celebration art exhibit at an art museum in Beijing. He is a former president of the Illinois State Poetry Society and a member of the Poets Club of Chicago. Dr. Marr and his wife, Jane, who is also an Argonne scientist, live in the Chicago suburbs, and they have 2 sons, Dennis and Alvin. Please welcome William Marr.
Thank you.
Wow, that's quite an impressive biography.
Thank you.
I guess I'm most really impressed with the trilingual book. So do you write, what drew you to writing it in French as well as Chinese and
English? It's not my writing.
Oh, okay.
It's a translation.
Okay, so you worked with a translator.
You know that I have on my internet, on the internet, I have a website, my personal website called The Art World of William Marr. And the French poet, he's very famous, he's in France, that read my poems and he liked it. So he contacted me that asked for permission for translation. I said, sure, go ahead. But they said, well, hey, let's do this here. He usually translates poetry into his French for money because he make a living.
Right.
But he said, well, this time, let's do this here. You translate 30 of my poems, and I translate 30 of yours.
Okay.
I said, okay, all right. But then when after he started, he just kept translating. He couldn't stop until 150 poems, something like that.
Oh, my goodness.
I said, no way I can keep up with you. Because
so that's
anyway,
too many poems.
So anyway, I probably translate 70, 75 of them, his poems, and published in Paris, too.
Now that is very clever. How did you meet this poet?
No, I never met him.
Oh, he just contacted you on
email,
the internet.
Email.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Right. So
that is wonderful.
Right. Actually, it's, several years ago, poet from a Jewish poet, okay, mm-hmm. contacted me that he said he liked my poems, so he mm-hmm. translated some of the poems and put in his website.
So, oh, wow.
Yeah,
okay.
That's so many.
So that would be Hebrew?
Hebrew.
Hebrew, okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah.
So, because I was thinking that not only were you a scientist and a poet, but that you were also this linguist where you were speaking all these different languages.
I wish.
Okay.
But it's impossible. I mean,
okay.
It's,
right.
So, English for me is, I started very late, okay, English.
Okay.
But so take the. Learning a language is not easy, unless
sure.
you start from very young. That's
right.
the thing. So.
So how old were you when you started learning English?
Like well, in high school.
High school.
Yeah, but
okay.
there, you know, you can read, but you can't speak.
Okay.
Well, it's difficult to speak. Even right now, people said, you know, your accent or something like that.
Right.
Even
But you've been here for
right,
a long
but
time.
You know the problem is that my wife is also from Taiwan, from China too.
Okay.
So we speak Mandarin at home.
Okay.
So there's no way that you can improve
the
language. That's the thing. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you've got so many poems. Although I am also impressed with the articles on nuclear, the science part of your brain. But what attracted you to poetry? I mean, why?
Well, there are several pivotal points. Actually, when I was young, in my fourth grade, there's a severe drought in my hometown, very severe. The clay or crack or everything.
No water.
No water.
Okay.
So the teacher asked us to write an article praying for rain. So we did. And I turned in my article, and next day when I went to school, this poem bearing my name posted on the bulletin board. And I said, well, gee, how could that be? But my teacher broke up the lines in my article and put in the form of the poem. And that kind of sparked my interest. But it happened that my uncle, he's very fond of Chinese classical literature and painting. He was a overseas businessman from Vietnam. Okay, he ran a business in Vietnam. That time he came home on vacation, and he read the poem. He really liked it. So whenever there's a visitor came to our house, he would recite the poem to the visitor.
Okay.
That really started my interest in poetry.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's always good to have a supportive audience and an uncle that memorizes your poem. That's
right,
great.
Right.
Do you remember the poem?
No. That's a problem. I remember the last two lines.
Okay. What are the last two lines?
They said, well, please come down. They rain.
Okay,
rains. Okay. Save millions of lives.
Save millions of lives. Please come down. Save millions of lives. Well, that would be good. Did it work?
Sure, eventually the rain came, but I mean, another thing really sparked my poetry writing is that when I went to, I was born in Taiwan, right?
You just mentioned
it. Then I spent my childhood in China, in a small village in China, in southern China. Then after the Second World War, we went back to Taiwan. My father and I went back to Taiwan. We went to school. And then after the high school, I went to the college, engineering college, to study mechanical engineering.
Okay.
And I didn't know that mechanical engineering is so dry. So
dry, boring.
Right. Okay. So I said, well, no, I can't do that. So, but there's no way. At that time, very rigid. The system very rigid. You cannot get out. Once you get in, you cannot get out.
Oh, so you didn't have an option.
No.
If you didn't like it, and you thought it was boring.
You cannot transfer to another school or anything. But
okay.
Anyway, so I, a couple of classmates and I started a school publication. I was the editor.
Okay.
And then I have to write all kinds of stuff. Stories, essays, and poems.
Okay.
And to fill the empty spaces, pages. Okay. That kind of second thing is from there. Okay.
All right.
But the third thing is the when I graduated from Marquette, I worked in Milwaukee. Okay. At that time, a friend of mine, he's a poet in Taiwan. He's a young poet, very well known. He was editor of the Poetry by Monthly in Taiwan. So he asked me, whether we can translate American poetry for the magazine on a regular basis.
Okay.
Every 2 months, I have to read a book, translate a book almost.
Oh my.
Yeah, for the magazine.
So this book is these are your translations
into Chinese
of classic poets.
Not classic, most of contemporary. Yeah.
Okay.
Well, some classic. I mean, you'd be considered T.S. Eliot and Robert Frost, those people, classical. Yeah. Okay, that's fine.
Well,
but,
I guess I guess it's all a matter of perspective.
To me, I think they're still pretty contemporary to me.
That's true. So people like William Carlos Williams, Emily Dickinson.
Yes.
So these are your translations into Chinese.
Yeah.
Wow, fabulous.
Mm-hmm. Then also kind of on the end of the translation, also ask some comments about the poetry, about the poem, that kind of stuff.
Oh, neat. Okay.
So it's, lots of people like it in Taiwan.
Well, now, so you said that since mechanical engineering was so dry and boring, and that you had to find this creative outlet
with
poetry and the literary magazine, is there any connection or relationship between scientific thought and poetry, or are they divorced?
I think so, because I think that lots of people find lots of good. The refined quality in my poems, they said, well, most likely it came from my scientific training.
Okay.
I think that's good too. I think.
You tend to like the more compact forms.
Right.
Now, is that just because that's similar to Chinese poetry, or?
Yes, Chinese classical poetry is like that. Very few words can express a lot of stuff.
Well, that's true.
Yeah. So my definition of poetry. A good poem is that use the least amount of words to express the most deepest feelings.
Okay. Using the least amount of words to express the most deepest feelings.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a very good.
That's my idea.
Okay.
So, but whether I succeed or not, I'm not quite sure.
Well, I'd love to hear some of your poems.
Okay.
Could you read some for us? That would be great.
Yeah. Actually, let me. One of the two poems get selected into the last 300 best
poems.
Oh,
right, okay.
For the last 100 years in China, two. So two out of 300 with 150 poets.
Okay, I have to ask, if you're at all competitive, now your friend who originally asked you to translate, is his poem?
All right.
Oh, he's got poems
in
that?
Okay. He's a pretty good one. Actually, he's a pretty good one. But anyway, let me read that poem first. The one is called Birdcage.
Birdcage?
Birdcage. Open the cage. Let the bird fly away. Give freedom back to the bird cage. That's it.
You better read it again.
Okay. Open the cage. Let the bird fly away. Give freedom back to the bird cage. Now, there's an interesting story in this here that a co-worker, Agang, read this poem. He said he really liked it. But he said, I don't know what you're talking about. what the real meaning of it? I said, well, you have to figure out. I'm not going to tell you, okay? I never tell people what the poems are about. But anyway, one day he came into my office and said, hey, Garrett. I said, what do you get? I said, what do you get? It's we are the bird. We are the cage. Ah. O.J. Simpson is a bird. Not that time the O.J. Simpson the murder
trial,
case
right,
trial.
Right, right.
Every day, the TV show is just O.J. Simpson
yes.
Trial. He said, now we let him go,
okay.
Fly away.
Right.
We're free. I say, wow.
Okay,
I say, oh, well, that's maybe one of the,
many
interpretations. Right, exactly. I say, well, I'm pretty sure that you will find many more. But anyway, that's one of the things, and this is the it's in the textbook in China, in Taiwan.
Oh, okay.
This poem here. And lots of people talk about, even today, they still talk about this poem. What really mean, okay?
Yeah.
But, the relationship between family and children could be one, okay?
Yeah.
Or the company with the workers, or the government
yes.
With the people,
right.
Okay? So, all like that, yeah.
No, you're wise to let the reader
right.
bring
right.
its
Thanks.
Own,
right. Right.
not tell them
right.
what it's all about,
right.
but
right.
Let the reader
yeah.
bring their vision.
Exactly. So that's what one of the
and obviously, sometimes readers will bring new interpretations to it
right, right, right,
that
right.
you never imagined.
No, but people told me that they read it, they put usually put my book beside their bed or whatever,
okay.
and that they whenever they have time they read it, and they said every time they read it, they get different meaning.
Mm.
I said, well, that's exactly what I intend for. No,
okay.
intent to have
well,
this
probably
kind of
because it's so the poems are
so
short
right,
and
so compact. Right. You can put anything in it.
Right.
Well, I think my idea is that the job of a poet is really to set up a stage, okay, let the event or character or whatever perform itself.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. Try to inspire the reader to bring their own. Imagination into it, and then create their own play.
Yeah.
Okay. That's my idea. Is that a good poem should be like that. Okay. If you tell them this is the way I want it,
yeah.
and every time you read it, exactly the same thing, you won't grow. So
right.
I think the poem should be interesting that it can grow. Every time we get different stuff. Every time you it's a new poem to you, because everybody experience different.
Yes.
Even yourself, the mood of the day you read it, okay, read the poem or the different experience. So I think that's the way that I think. Anyway, that's my interpretation
okay.
of poem poetry.
Yes.
That should be like that. I don't want to tell them that what I mean here.
Right.
Okay.
But let's read some more.
Okay. Here. Let's see here. Another poem is a drunk. Because I left China in 1949.
Okay.
Okay, to Taiwan. Right afterwards, the communist China took over.
Oh, okay. Wow.
So cut off our family. My mother, my brother, sister, all in China mainland. Oh. And my father and myself and my older brother in Taiwan.
In Taiwan.
We
okay.
separated for 30 years. Mm. 30 years without any communication at all. Okay?
Oh, wow.
And I wrote this one here. It's called Homesick Drunk. The Homesick Drunk. He has walked a short alley into a torturous, writhing intestine of 10,000 miles. One step left, 10 years. One step right, 10 years. Oh, mother, I am struggling towards you.
Mm.
Let me read again. Before, when I read in Chinese, I can never finish it.
Oh,
they asked
yeah.
me to read this one, I can read it. It's too emotional. Right now,
sure.
I think it's probably getting better. He has walked a short alley into a torturous, writhing intestine of 10,000 miles. One step left, 10 years. One step right, 10 years. Oh, mother, I am struggling toward you.
Mm.
Now, this poem really provoked lots of people overseas, Chinese especially, because they also same thing like my situation,
right.
cut off from the connection
family.
Between the family. They really love this one here.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
I'm not that struck. I mean, so when you went to Taiwan,
mm-hmm.
how soon after you arrived in Taiwan was the
less than a year?
Less than a year.
Yeah.
So you had expected to be able to go home.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah. So nobody expected that. So anyway,
wow.
So let's, in the poem there, 10,000 miles is, we have a Great Wall, right?
Yes.
China. That's 10,000 miles.
Oh,
okay.
Okay,
so I kind of
yeah.
put that into it. And,
right. kind
of, and the mother here, lots of people interpret, not only my mother,
right.
is also China. The nation.
Yeah.
Okay, also the culture.
Mm-hmm.
The culture too. Okay, so they kind of lots of association.
So is this
things.
The other poem that was in the textbook?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. The textbook and also
300
poems.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's this one here. Now let's see here. Well, I'll give you another one. A little bit lighter.
Okay, a little lighter. That's good. That's good. Got to have a mix.
Sharing an umbrella. Sharing an umbrella. I suddenly realized the difference between us. Yet bending over to kiss you, give me such joy as you try to meet me halfway on tiptoe. Sharing an umbrella. Again, the thing here that we people may interpret that a couple of lovers under this umbrella kissing, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you can also that people in people, organization, religion and religion, country,
mm-hmm.
Nation and nation, they all can do the same thing. You have to really compromise each
right.
other, try to, right? So that is my something here that you can interpret, you can imagine. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
One more time.
Okay. Sharing an umbrella. Sharing an umbrella. I suddenly realized the difference between us. Yet bending over to kiss you, give me such joy as you try to meet me halfway on tiptoe.
Mm.
Okay?
I like that.
Let's see here. Next poem I think I'm going to read is the Road. Twisting and turning, yet the road constantly draws people forward. It never thinks of itself as the only right way. At every crossing, there's always a big sign pointing to what town, how many miles. Do you want me to read one
more
time?
Yes, one more time.
Okay. Twisting and turning, yet a road constantly draws people forward. It never thinks of itself as the only right way. At every crossing, there's always a big sign pointing to what town, how many miles. Okay, give you a lighter one.
Okay.
Well, usually I try to put humor into poetry, in a poem. I think that's very important.
I'm personally quite fond of humor in poetry.
Right.
And I feel like publishers don't look at my poems because they say, oh, she's not serious enough.
Right, that's wrong. I think really, humor really is very important. To me, it's very important in a poem. Because you can, after you read the humor, there's lots of things behind it, mm-hmm. okay? So I think it's, if you can put humor in a poem, I think it's really good. Anyway, this gravity. After thinking the matter through, the apple gracefully let itself go. Oops, it landed right on the head of Mr. Newton, dozing under the tree. Gravity. After thinking the matter through, the apple gracefully let itself go. Oops, it landed right on the head of Mr. Newton, dozing under the tree.
Well, see, there, now there you are, getting science and poetry together,
right.
as well as humor.
Yep. Okay, here another one is Lake Louise. The Canadian.
Canada's Lake Louise.
Okay. So delicate, so vulnerable, in a chamber deep in the high mountains, alone. There's got to be a sign guarding this little girl of God. No dinosaurs allowed, no noisy tourists allowed.
Let's look at your other book. We're winding down.
Okay.
We only have a couple more moments, so maybe we can get another poem.
Okay. This Yellow River poem. No, Yellow River is the big river in China.
Okay.
Running from west to east, across the 2,800 miles.
Okay.
The long one. Okay. It floods every year.
Okay.
Okay, almost every year. And witnessed many, many bloody wars.
Okay.
Okay. And but it's they call mother of civilization of China. Okay, it's this river.
This river,
yeah.
Okay.
Yellow River. If you trace up the turbid current, you will find, as any geography book can tell you, the Kunlun Mountains in Qinghai. Yet according to history bloody accounts, this river, which turned clear almost once in 1,000 years, has its origin in millions of eye sockets of suffering human beings. Now, I do want to read a couple, two more poems. One, because it's...
I don't know if we have time, but...
Okay, that's fine. Doesn't matter. It's the Venom War Memorial.
Okay.
Okay. This
Vietnam War Memorial.
Yeah, this poem was posted in a PBS website.
Okay.
It's called Vietnam Story Since the War. The war. They have a war.
Right.
You click on the war, the first poem is this one here.
Okay, we need to read it because we're running out of time.
Okay.
But that's okay.
Vietnam War Memorial. A block of marble and 26 letters of the alphabet enabled history to accommodate so many young names. Wandering around, an old woman has at last found her only child among the many. And with her eyes tightly shut, she is now feeling for the mortal wound with her trembling. trembling.